It's a pleasure and an honor to have the opportunity to discuss this very important topic with you today. As Carla said, I've been working with the Afghan community for many years, and I have had first-hand experience working with them in terms of mental health issues, in terms of the community issues that they deal with on a daily basis, and I would like to share some of that with you. I would like to basically go over three main objectives today. One is to talk about their unique characteristic and historical experiences moving from Afghanistan to the United States, and also discuss some of the cultural and social barriers to receiving health care and facts regarding faith-based belief system when it comes to working with the Afghan elders. So what are some of the issues that we need to keep in mind when we're working with the Afghan elders? And also talk about some strategies that our healthcare providers can incorporate the religious and the cultural beliefs that can enhance the quality of the Afghan elders and their caregivers. So this is basically what I'll be covering today. So today's presentation, I'm going to go basically over the Afghan history, background of, and the history of the Afghans, their immigration pattern in the United States, and some of the health status of the immigrants that are available. As I will let you know, there's not that much information about the Afghan health situation here in the United States. And what is the role of Islam and the Islamic perspectives in the life of the Afghans? And what are some of the barriers that they have here accessing healthcare? And how can we develop culturally appropriate assessment tools? And what are some of the treatment issues that we need to consider when we're working with the Afghan community? And what about the caregivers? How do we talk to the caregivers? What are they feeling? What are the Afghan caregivers dealing with on a daily basis? And also, what are some of the factors that providers can enhance their communication skills with caregivers and the Afghan families? So we have a lot on the list today. So how many of you know the background of the Afghan community here in the United States? Okay, so I'll go over some of that. So as we know, here's a map of Afghanistan. As we know, it's a landlocked country, and it is located in South and Central Asia. And as you can see from the neighboring countries, it has a lot of interaction with different communities and different countries around the world. And the impact of these countries in the cultural and the religious patterns of the country is apparent within the differences that we can see in their languages, in their traditions, in their celebrations. For example, in the south of Afghanistan, which is close to Pakistan, they speak Pashtun. So that's a specific language related to the Pakistani influence in Afghanistan. And on the other side, which is Iran, they speak very closely to the Persian Farsi, the Darius language, which is close to that. And they have their own traditions on that way. And on the north, we can see Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and they speak Uzbek and Tajik. So you can see the huge, you can see that is a huge difference in the languages and the tradition, the culture of this country. And the two main languages spoken in Afghanistan are Pashto and Dari, and these are the both official and widely spoken. Afghanistan is a nomadic and a tribal society. So it's very important to consider this information as we work with the Afghan community and keep this in mind, that they all have different backgrounds, they all come from different regions of the country, and they all speak different languages. So just when someone says, I'm from Afghanistan, you have to follow up and say, so which part of Afghanistan do you come from? If they come from the south, you can think, okay, so they probably speak Pashtun. So this is a way of thinking about the cultural diversity of this country. The population of Afghanistan is about 31 million, and it's the 15th least developed country in the world. It's a very underdeveloped country. Although things are getting a little bit better, but still we have a long way to go. And unfortunately, has one of the highest maternal and infant mortality rates in the world. And for example, 1 in 10 children die before they're 5 years old. So this is a very harsh statistics. And the reason for that is, as we know, Afghans have gone through many years, 3 or 4 years of drought, 23 years of war, and 5 years under the ruling of the Taliban. So as a result, who are usually suffering from these factors? What population is suffering most? What do you think? Yes, the children. Women and girls in Afghanistan are the ones who are at risk and are suffering the most. As we can see, they have been victims of conflict and drought and low health status. Over 90% of the births are given at home, are placed at home, and they have very low prenatal care. And unfortunately, many of the women are malnourished. So the reason for the malnourishment is, in addition to the low health status and the low privileges they have, it's also the traditional practices. For example, during the years of famine, the women would not eat and leave the food for the husbands and the children. So that's why they're malnourished. So this is the historical perspective that you keep in mind when you're talking to an Afghan woman who just immigrated from Afghanistan. Women and girls are restricted in their access to education, healthcare facilities, and employment in Afghanistan. Although things are, again, getting much better, but still we have a long way to go. And this is because of the economic and social conditions of women and girls in many areas of the country. For example, during the ruling of the Taliban, only about 3% of the girls had an education, only 3%. And so that's why they are in such a difficult situation. In addition to that, another important issue to consider is the issue of child marriage in Afghanistan. Child marriage is defined by the United Nations and the WHO as a marriage before the age of 18. And unfortunately, this is a very common trend in Afghanistan and many developing countries. Over 67 million child brides are around in the world. And this is, again, a big concern for the women around the world to have this kind of situation that they have to deal with. Child brides suffer health risks associated with early sexual activity and childbearing, leading to high rates of maternal and child mortality, as well as sexually transmitted infections, and including HIV, high rates of HIV in Afghanistan. And of course, the girls are more likely to be victims of domestic violence, abuse, and social isolation. So this is the background of the majority of the women and children that enter the United States. So how many of you knew the situation of the Afghan women? Okay, that's good. Okay, so as we know, the Afghans, when they enter the United States, this is a very basic statistics that we have. Unfortunately, there's not that much demographic information on the entry of the Afghans in the country. However, the census data, which is only an estimate of a randomized population, and it's not exact numbers, we have to understand that over 98,000 or more Afghans are in the United States, which is one of the largest refugee populations in the world. So we're working with the largest refugee population, and over 65,000 live in the San Francisco Bay Area. So, you know, we're dealing with this community right now on a daily basis, and unfortunately, a big problem is the 21% literacy rate, and a lot of the Afghans are illiterate in their own language of Dari and Pashto, and they're not only in English, in their own language. So illiteracy is very high. and 67% speak English not well or not at all. So what happens when the Afghans leave their country? Do you think they come straight into the United States? They don't. So what happens to them is that most of the women and children, majority of women and children, spend much of their lives, about some of them 10 to 15 years, in refugee camps in Pakistan or the neighboring countries, Iran. So that's also another risk factor added to the health disparities issues of the Afghan women and children. The men usually enter the United States, they find jobs, and they make a life, they rent a house, an apartment, then they bring their wives and children. However, that does take sometimes 10 to 15 years. And a lot of the women in the refugee camps are widows as well. So that's another issue we need to consider. Of course, you know, in a refugee camp, there are limited resources and stress, and therefore high levels of acute and chronic diseases. And the other problem that we have in terms of data is that there's not much information known about the health needs of the Afghans beyond a basic health assessment. So what do we know about the health status of the Afghan immigrants in the United States? Not, as I mentioned, there's not too much information in that sense, but upon entry in a refugee screening clinic at San Francisco General Hospital, of about 59 refugees, they found out that these were some of the main issues that the Afghans were dealing with, mostly dental problems and dermatological problems, intestinal parasites, GI issues. And in addition to that, only 12% was recorded regarding pain and psychosomatic symptoms, which is exactly not, you know, true, or it wasn't reported, because these are some of the main issues that the Afghans are dealing with on a daily basis. A study by Dr. Stemple in 2007 about the well-being of the Afghans showed that 43% of the Afghans were diagnosed with depression and PTSD. And how many of us knew this already, have dealt with that? Great. And as we expect, women are twice as likely as men to suffer from PTSD and depression. So these kind of findings, which are very scarce, there are not too many studies, again, on the Afghan community, shows that Afghan refugees have a high prevalence of psychiatric symptomology, which places them at risk for worse health outcomes in general. And as we know, they have been exposed to high levels of trauma and are at risk for chronic psychiatric and physical disabilities, such as post-traumatic disorder or PTSD. And as we know, PTSD is a syndrome of biopsychological processes that involves the brain, the nervous and hormonal systems, psychological systems of memory, cognition, motivation, perception, and behaviors, all influenced by trauma. PTSD has a prevalence of 8 to 12% in the general population and 43% in the Afghan community. And as we know, it is a risk factor for psychological stress and high rates of suicide and inability to work. And as a matter of fact, just a couple of weeks ago, two women committed suicide in Fremont due to PTSD. And it happens on a regular, unfortunately, on a regular basis, attempts of suicide and actual, the suicide itself. And it also leads to a high levels of inability to work. And in addition to having PTSD, we know that increases the medical conditions such as cardiovascular disease, hypertension, and diabetes. Studies have shown that both traumatic brain injury and PTSD stress disorder is associated with increased risk of cognitive decline and dementia. And these are some recent studies. And in a veteran cohort, the people who were diagnosed as having PTSD were at nearly twofold higher risk of developing dementia compared with those without PTSD. So to reduce the increased risk of dementia associated with PTSD, mechanisms linking these important disorders need to be identified. These were the findings of a recent study by Yaffe. So the finding that PTSD is associated with a double of risk of dementia has important public health and policy and biological implications. And we know as the people with PTSD age, they have adverse health conditions, and some have suggested that PTSD accelerates the aging process. And it's also important to think about the Afghan elders with PTSD in order to screen them for cognitive impairments with the hope of finding ways to improve their current situation. And that's a really important factor to consider. And as we know, the issue of PTSD and comorbidities is a huge important issue in the Afghan immigrant community. The Afghans do not have access to any preventive health care in Afghanistan or in the camps that they came from. So the idea of preventive health is a very new concept to them. So when we tell them that you need to exercise to lose weight or you need to prevent diabetes, we have to find new strategies to talk to them about these issues. And models that integrate care to treat multiple health concerns are not implemented effectively in the Afghan community. So how do Afghans cope with all these issues that they come with, what they deal with on a daily basis? So Afghans, the majority of Afghans are Muslims, and the idea of Islam is a big part of their lives. Islamic values are influential in most of the Afghan lives and many of the Muslims, and the way that they follow the Islamic concepts is the way that they articulate about health. So being a Muslim gives you an answer in terms of how you talk to an Afghan or to a Muslim about health issues. And that does take some thinking of how to articulate that to a Muslim Afghan. So it's really good to have an understanding of how religious values influence health behaviors of Afghan elders, and it will result in the delivery of culturally sensitive healthcare services for Afghans. So as we know, Islam is the second largest religion in the world, more than 1.6 billion adherents, and about 23% of the global population are Muslim. And in the United States, there are 5 to 7 million Muslims in the US, and they all come from diverse backgrounds with over 75 different ethnicities and nationalities. Regardless of that, it's considered a shared identity. It's a philosophical thinking about health and well-being and death and dying. It's the way of thinking. It's not just a merely rules that they need to follow. And it has a very high impact on their health status, which is independent of race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status. So if we use Islamic beliefs, we can use them as a positive resource in the face of illness and provide a lot of mental strength. For example, studies have shown among Afghans, African-American, Arab-American, South Asian-Americans that they believe both health and illness is given to them by Allah, which is God, and human beings play as just a complementary role. So this is a very important factor to consider when we're dealing with the Afghan American population. Another study by Dr. Marika Douglas, 2004, from Stanford University, indicated that Afghan elders in California believed an individual's health depends on whether the individual adhered to Islamic guidelines and performed religious rituals and the elders engaged in worship practices for the purpose of healing. So the worship was based on, I want to heal, I want to improve my health, and then so I worship. And one issue, Islamic perspective on aging is from the Quran, is the holy book of Muslims. Be kind to parents, whether one or both of them attain old age in their life. Say not to them a word of contempt, nor repel them, but address them in terms of honor, out of kindness, lower to them the wings of humility. Humility is a big issue. And say, my Lord, bestow on them thy mercy, even as they cherished me in childhood. So it goes back, the children taking care of their elderly parents. And then we can see in a video that will show how that works out. So Muslims might turn to Islam as a source of healing, and studies have shown that. And they experience mental and physical benefits from practices such as praying, fasting. So there's a 1 month of fasting in among Muslims. How many we know about the month of Ramadan? Wow, everyone knows. That's wonderful. Okay. And the recitation of the Quran, and there are specific requirements that you have to follow during the month of Ramadan for 30 days. So there are rules associated with that as well. So what are some of the cultural and social barriers to accessing healthcare for Afghans in general? So as we mentioned this, there's little or no concept of preventive health. The English proficiency is low, culture of male-controlling culture, isolation, having difficulty understanding, navigating the healthcare system, and also not having competent health navigators, a huge issue. And having communication problems with the providers, scheduling appointments, and transportation difficulties. These are some of the main barriers that Afghans have on a daily basis to deal to access healthcare. So another issue that when the Afghans immigrate to the United States feel is that a change in status from being heads of the household for the men who are honored for their age and experience to being dependent on their adult children and grandchildren. This is a huge issue. When the Afghan male enters the United States, his wife has to enter the job market if she's educated enough, and then there's no status for him in the household, and that has led to high levels of depression, anxiety, and also even suicide in the Afghan community. There is a lost identity roles, again, women being forced out, and this has also led to a high rate of domestic violence in the Afghan community. And also a change in lifestyle, so from being an active member of the community to being unknown to the community. No one knows you when you go to the park, everyone is a stranger to you, and you are unfamiliar with the environment, and you just don't feel that you belong, and this is a big issue for the Afghans. The other issue about talking about health factors and health problems, they're not, Afghan elder men especially, they are not used to sharing their problems with others. It's against their ghaira. Ghaira is a word means personal pride in Farsi, and it's just not done. They don't want to talk about their problems. So they believe that the family problems are private and should be just solved with the extended family circles. So talking to their physicians about their health problems is a very difficult job. And then burden of the loss of a spouse and other personal traumas as refugees is a huge challenge for them. Two main issues that we need to consider when we're working with the Afghans is the issue of acculturation and abandonment. And acculturation is the extent to which an individual complies to the new society that they're living in. And it's a very difficult issue for the aging Afghan to acculturate to a new society. It's one of the main problems that we have to deal with. And the same issue of abandonment. They feel that nobody cares for them anymore. They feel abandoned, they feel lost, and their families are not here with them. So according to a refugee, he said that our Afghan elders are really suffering in terms of not knowing where to go for care. They do not have relatives, they stay home, and they're really depressed. So how can we develop a culturally competent assessment tool and treatment for these patients that we're talking about? In terms of a background, unfortunately, there are not precise statistics available on the incidence and prevalence of dementia in the Afghan immigrant community. And there's a lack of epidata on dementia, mood, and anxiety disorders among the Afghan elders. Unfortunately, most of the prevalence statistics are also from smaller group studies, and the measurement tools and correlates of psychological distress in specific ethnic groups. So that we don't have good population-based studies. So there's a critical need for population-based studies to understand the epidemiological burden of dementia on the individual, family, and society in this population. And no one has really attempted to do that so far. So what are some of the issues in health disparities research? One of the main issues that we have is most of the tools that we have or the studies that we have are self-reported measures that are tested in mainstream well-educated groups, so they don't apply to this population that we just discussed. And there's not really that much information how well they work in disparate groups such as the Afghan community. There's lack of reliability, validity, and appropriateness for these tools. The other issue that's really important to consider in the Afghan community is the treatment, the medication consideration. So as we know, medication management in dementia is a broad concept. It should include a complete review of medication, including assessment of medication, dose, interaction, and continued need. And this is a huge gap in research in this issue with the Afghans as well. We don't have any information about the medications of the Afghans. A big issue among the Afghan community is polypharmacy. And as we know, there's an 8% increase in the number of medications taken for additional diseases. And as they're diagnosed with comorbid diseases, there's higher recommendation for additional use of medications, therefore leading to falls and fractures due to the side effect of medications and leading to a lot of falls and fractures with high mortality and morbidity. So this is a big issue to talk about. And now we reach to the issue of caregiving in a changing world and how does that impact culture and diversity. And I'd like to show a video of the caregiver that we interviewed and her experience with her caregiving situation.
Salam Marina Jan. How are you? Thanks for coming here today to talk about your caregiving responsibilities and the challenges you face on a daily basis. Please introduce yourself and then we will start our discussion.
Okay, thank you so much, Aida Jan. My name is Marina Salu and I'm a caregiver for my mother-in-law. It's almost three or four years that I'm doing this job for my mother-in-law. And actually we came to the United States more than 4 years before. And since that time, I'm responsible for caregiving of her.
Could you just tell us the story of, why you are in this position? Why is that you're the only caregiver of your mother-in-law and if anyone is supporting you?
When I came to the United States, I didn't have any job in my country. I was a medical doctor, so it was very frustrating that I didn't have any job, and I tried to get a job to support my family and myself. And for the second point, based on our religious points of view, so a member of family should be responsible for their elder. So for that reason, I chose that job to take care of my mother-in-law.
So do you have anyone helping you with this responsibility, and how is the level of the caregiving? Is it very extensive or not?
Actually, nobody is helping me at that point. I'm the only person that I'm helping all the things for my mother-in-law, and I'm doing everything for her. And for the first time when I started the caregiver job, so it was very hard for me. And it was difficult, but after a time, it's much easier now that I'm doing everything for her.
Okay, so tell me about more about what your responsibilities are and yours. Do you have any support, anyone, you know, do you take her to different places? So explain more about your role.
All the things that a patient or a person that has dementia and Alzheimer needs, I do for my mother-in-law. I'm feeding her. I'm giving a bath and washing her clothes and cleaning her room and everything that she needs. And sometimes I take her outside for sightseeing or for that she needs somewhere to go. I took her everywhere. And barely my daughter, she helps me because she is also a student and she goes to school and she doesn't have enough time to help me a lot. But sometimes when I need her help, I ask for her help. But the rest of the time, I'm 24/7 responsible for my mother-in-law's thing, that everything that she needs, I must do.
And I believe that you're also a mother of four young children and your husband is not here
exactly,
in the country.
Exactly. And based on the, aside with the caregiving to my mother-in-law, I'm also responsible for my kids, for their education and the responsibilities that I have as a mother at home and taking care of my mother-in-law. So sometimes it gets difficult because I used to handle both sides, the things that my mother-in-law needs and the things that my children need.
Okay, so how does this affect your personal life and in terms of stress and issues with your health?
Sometimes it's getting hard day by day because when I'm responsible for caregiving of my mother-in-law. I don't have enough time to do something for myself. Even when I take my mother-in-law out from her bed to the living room, it takes lots of time. And sometimes I feel back pain, so it's very difficult for me because she is also a human being, and me too. It's a heavy thing to take it and push it and take it to either room or to the bath. So sometimes it's very stressful. When I feel stress, sometimes I get very
frustrated,
yes. So, but I don't have any choice to do with that because I'm the only person to as a responsible for my mother-in-law.
So have you tried looking in the community for some resources to help you with the stress and the possibly depression that you might feel with your caregiving responsibilities?
Actually, I searched a lot, but there is no any community resources to help me or my mother-in-law because I'm the only person as a caregiver to my mother-in-law, but I searched a lot and tried to find some way or some places to help her, but unfortunately, I couldn't find any place. So based on our religion, we are responsible for our elders. And as a Muslim woman, my mother-in-law also needs a person to be the same religion as she is. So this is the only thing that I can't do anything with this limitation that we have.
So if there were community resources, either in a mosque or center that provided your Islamic way of life and helped you in that way, would you go to that center?
Exactly. Of course, we can. We can use it. Or the only thing that we wanted to do is the ways that our religious things allows us. So if there is any possible way or any place to help us, we can use it at least once a time or once a week. We can use that one.
Okay. Is there anything else, Marina John, you would like to add for our viewers about this issue?
Of course, I have a client for that reason. As a caregiver, I don't have any health insurance to for myself to go somewhere to get some help. Sometimes when I feel very frustrated or stressful, so there's no any place to go, and I can't do without any health insurance. So the thing that I just need. For myself, for other caregivers, health insurance to use it if we need.
Okay, thank you so much, Marina. I really appreciate your time.
Okay, well, this was a story of a caregiver, and I'm really happy to share this story with you because this is a view of many Afghan women who are caregivers in our community, and we wanted their voices to be heard and for you guys to understand what are some of the challenges that they're facing on a daily basis. And although they feel that it's their religious and cultural duty to take care of an elder, they're dealing with all these difficulties that she mentioned in terms of her own health, in terms of not having anybody to go to, in terms of isolation, and being a mother of so many children. It's a daunting task. And so she did look at the resources in the community, and unfortunately, again, she didn't find any. So the impacts of dementia is not doesn't only influence the patients, but also many of the family members. And we should also consider that the caregivers are not only responsible to provide timely and appropriate care, but they also have to answer to the demands of their own families. So this is a very important issue for us to take with us. In Afghan culture, it's believed that caring is the community's duty and obligation, and however, they can really benefit from social support, maintaining social activities, psychological interventions that teach them coping skills, and unfortunately, that's not available for the caregivers. Again, another issue for the Muslim community is placing their elderly parents in a nursing home. It's difficult for Muslims to find nursing homes and assisted living facilities that reflect their way of life. The reason is because they don't speak the language, so people can't communicate with them. Life in a majority of residential facilities would be an alien experience to them. And so that's another issue to consider. When the early times, the women lived in the house and took care of their elderly parent, the traditional model of a full-time stay-at-home caregiver will not survive as the elderly population increases and the Muslim women step into the workforce. So what's going to happen to the elderly parents? And it's a huge decision for Afghans to place an elderly family in a facility. So we should think about envision facilities where ethnicity and religions would be taken into consideration. Also, we must recognize that the elder Afghan community has many issues, that they are part of our elderly community. They're not separate. We need more social support groups within our own community, more things we can do together as a community as a whole. how can we improve our communication with caregivers and Afghan families? So it's really important that I discuss the issue of the Afghan experience with you in terms of coming from Afghanistan as a developing country and going into nursing homes, to camps, and the issue of trauma and the refugee. So the first step in improving care is to find out about the refugee elders' background and to develop a trust and understanding of the refugee experience. It's okay to ask them about the background. So how long have you been in a camp, and when did you go? What country did you go to? These are okay to ask them. Be mindful of working with refugees as they have been through so much pain and hardship. Have knowledge of services for refugees in their community. Get involved in training opportunities and understand ways of working with Afghan elders and their families. Be aware of the wide spectrum of adherence, religious practices, and traditions within this community. As I mentioned, Afghans are a multicultural community, and they come from different backgrounds. Even when you see a patient, ask them if they prefer same-gender providers and make good faith to do so if they request it. Informing a patient in advance, for example, very simple things that when a person of the other gender may need to enter the room in case she wants to fix her hijab. This is very important in developing trust with the Afghans. When speak to them, try to use short, simple sentences. Try to deal with one thing at a time. Ask about their historical context. That's very important. Ask about when you're asking about the symptoms, don't just focus on the pain, because there are histories that are causing the pain. Find out why, where the pain is coming from, not just where does it hurt, because this is all coming from a historical perspective. If the person appears not able to understand you, then rephrase the sentence in a different way. It's okay to use touch as a method of friendship and reassurance when you're talking to them, but sometimes when you're talking to a female patient, holding their hand or touching may not be appropriate because of Islamic religious beliefs. And they might not look you into the eye, but that is due to the cultural reasons. That's not because they don't respect you or they don't like you. It's just a cultural thing. And it's very important to have trained interpreters working with the Afghan. An Afghan medical doctor said, well, I think it's a relationship that you build, listening to them, finding out a little bit about how they see things and see the world. I found it's good having a bit of an understanding about their cultural background. So I'd say it's more the relationship that's most helpful in working with refugee families. So, saying from Maya Angelou at the end, I've learned that I still have a lot to learn. I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. Thank you.
The question from the audience pertains to the video clip and was a particular question about how the woman is supporting herself, her four kids, and also the mother-in-law. It seems incredible that one woman could do all of those things.
Well, as much as I know about Marina's life situation as a scenario, her husband works in Afghanistan and travels to Pakistan. He has a full-time job, so he makes money in dollar. Because if you work in another country, in a developing country, you're not going to make the euro or the dollar that he can send over to them. And he has a United Nations position. She's lucky. So that's how she's supporting herself. And also, the mother-in-law receives some kind of privileges because of the refugee status. They do receive privileges as well. And their children as well, except her, the other ones do. So this is how they, make it.
Another question? Yes. It would be greatly preferred if we could, would you be willing to take the microphone? Thank you.
Just a quick question. She said she is religiously bound to only go to Afghan providers? So under what circumstances would those of us who are not of that ethnic see a patient like this or encounter?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Thank you for that. By talking about going to an Afghan provider, her main point was going to a Muslim provider. And this is just the boundaries of her situation. And she has, you know, tried really hard to reach out to the providers that are available, but they haven't been able to help her. But if we understand as providers, for example, how to treat a Muslim woman, there's not going to be any problems. It's just crossing those barriers. For example, very simple things that I mentioned, eye contact and, the issue of the month of Ramadan, for example, having this kind of understanding of the culture and the religious of Afghan women really breaks the barriers. And this is how you can help.
Thank you.
pardon me, yes, I'm Maureen Cook. And what kind of breaks my heart, actually, is this woman is a physician. Is that correct?
Yes,
she said she was a medical doctor.
Yeah.
So here she, and I know it's not just the Afghan community. It's many refugees that people leave behind or lose all their professional sense of self as well as what they can offer. I'm glad to hear her husband works. Gives me hope for the future. But anyway, I was just thinking that that's another really frustration, I would imagine, and a big loss for her individually and for a lot of women.
Thank you so much for that wonderful comment. You're right. This is a huge pain for the community. She lived in a camp for 7 years in a Pakistani camp with all the children. And she's a trained OBGYN, but now here she's in the United States, losing everything, her sense of self, as you mentioned, and not being able to do anything about it is worse than anything. So the project that we have with the Alameda County Health Disparities is working with individuals who are in such professions and teaching them skills to be able to work in the communities as speakers in Farsi and be able to do presentations because they can't really practice and getting it, you know, going through the exams is very difficult for them. So we try to engage them in something that is exciting to them and makes sense to them. And so she's trained as a navigator right now. She's about 45.
Yeah. Yes. Hello. I have a question about the working with their religious beliefs. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there was a slide that stated, you know, disease was given by health or disease is given by Allah,
yes.
And you know. Normally, I would think I'm trying to destigmatize, normalize, you know, you have illnesses not because Allah is giving you the disease, you mm-hmm. know. Because I deal with that in Chinese mm-hmm. population mm-hmm. too. Sometimes they believe in karma. And so then what would be your response to try to lessen the guilt or shame or, yeah.
Thank you so much for your question. Actually, a way to look at this is not from the lens of shame or guilt. The way that I look at it is a way of basically being humble. It's a humility situation. So when they say that my illness or my health is from Allah, that means you're submitting to what happens to you in this life. And it's not because you're shamed, it's because you're giving your faith to the higher power and you have a belief system that's eventually going to work out with you. So this is the way to look at it. And you don't look at it as a negative, you look at it as a positive thing. And then you go along with it, that you say, okay, I understand this is your belief, but this is how I can help you to gain your health back.
Okay, I see. It's just not going against the beliefs.
No.
And don't, yeah, okay.
And just to point out, this is not solely for the Muslim faith. Also for South Asians and other communities, there are concepts of even Latin American communities, fatalismo. So I think this you could see this as a more broad concept that one could hearken to when addressing many race, ethnic, diverse populations. Are there other questions from the audience? Okay, fantastic. I will just ask one. When speaking with an Afghani elder in the clinic, what is the proper form of address? How shall we address Afghani elders if you encounter them in your clinic?
That's a really good question. If you're talking about addressing a male Afghani, the provider usually stands up and shakes hands with them at the same eye level, and it's respectful to stand up when a person comes in and they shake hands. And sometimes if they're really close to the provider, they even give a hug or something like that. But if it's a female, obviously there's no shaking of hands or try to not gaze at the patient, and just try to keep a distance and wait till the woman opens up and start asking questions slowly. But if there's kind of an aggressive, short temper questions, they will not answer. They close up. Yeah.
And just following up from that, are there any cultural mistakes or things that providers should avoid when working with the Afghan community?
I think, we all have really great intentions, and you all do a great job with working with all the communities that you work with. And I think it's just maintaining a respect, a culture of respect and integrity is the bottom line.
And that's a fantastic point to end on, in fact, using the principles of cultural humility, integrity, respect, work with all people, regardless of culture or race. And so that's a great point to end on. I'd like everyone to give a round of applause for Dr. Shirazi.